Good morning, First Baptist Church Aztec. Thank you for joining us today. If this is your first time here, please fill out a guest information tear-off in the bulletin and bring it to the First Cafe to meet Pastor Mike and receive your favorite candy bar and soda. If you're looking for a church home, you found a great place. Here are some things happening at First Baptist. VBS is almost here. We need you to serve, pray, and bring children to Vacation Bible School. It is June 24th through the 28th. There is still room for you to serve. Sign up today in the First Cafe. We are having a block party to kick off Vacation Bible School Friday, June 21st. Please join us to reach out and welcome others at Lydia Rippey from 6 to 8 p.m. See Katie Baird for more details. Our students and sponsors left yesterday for Glorietta. Please pray for them that they may draw closer to God and have a great time. Senior adults, are you 55 or older? Come join us Thursday at noon in the Fellowship Hall for lunch and fellowship. After lunch, there's an opportunity to engage in ministry work for our church and community. Come for some fun, fellowship, food, and bring a friend. Do you have an extra bed in your home? Are you willing to allow your home to be used as a place of ministry? We have a ministry team coming from out of state that will need a place to stay while they are working alongside us. Please contact Katie Baird or Rachel Nichols for more details. For more information about upcoming events, check the bulletin or our website at firstaztec.org. Thanks again for joining us today. Now, open up your heart and enjoy what God will do the rest of the service this morning.
Good morning, everybody. Doesn't it look beautiful in here today? I wonder what all the fuss is about. So exciting to be a part of this today, Jason. So excited. Why don't we stand together this morning, because we are going to start the service worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed. By the power of your love.
I'm just anxious.
It's in Genesis 2, starting with verse 15. And if your Bible is on page 2. The Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone, and I will make him a helper suitable for him." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the beasts of the field, all the birds of the air. He brought them to man to see what he would name them, and whatever the name called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave name to all the livestock, the birds of the air, and all the beasts of the field. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord gave man a woman from his rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now my bone of bones, my flesh of flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of me." Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the series that we've had on the family and what it means to be one, where two has come together to be one and to worship you. As these things in thy name. Amen.
Be seated, please.
Good save.
I caught it.
You do.
Brian Sanders is laughing even before it went all the way down. He's like, "Oh, I want to see this happen." That's what a friend is for, right there. Really. Then can we rewind it? That's what I want to know. Today is a very special day. It is. It's a very special day. And some of you are here and you don't even know why things are different, and that's okay. We have been planning and preparing for this special day, and I'm excited about it for many reasons. Today is Pentecost Sunday. And some of you may be aware of that. You may not be aware of that. If you don't know what that is, that means it's the day that the Holy Spirit was sent to the church. The Holy Spirit was sent, and we celebrate Pentecost Sunday as God's gift to us as his followers. You see, the Spirit of God was sent to strengthen the bride and to give courage and strength and guidance to the bride of Christ. That's us. The Holy Spirit was sent to give these things and strengthen the bride of Christ, the church, in preparation for the return of the Son of God, for the glory of God. And so today, as we reaffirm, some of us choose to reaffirm our love and commitment to our spouses, we might should just take a moment and reaffirm our love and commitment to the Son of God, to the Father, and to the Holy Spirit that indwells us. Now for just a brief moment, let me read, and just for a second, Ephesians chapter 5. Because this is very important as we process our reaffirmation of our love to our spouses, reaffirmation of our love and commitment to our spouses, as well as this time that we have a wedding with Jason and Radina. Here's what the Word of God says. "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord, because the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He, Christ, is the Savior of the body." You see, when the Word of God says, "Wives, submit to your husbands," this submission is not being a doormat. This submission does not mean being walked on, and submission does not mean being taken advantage of or ran over. Submission is actually an act of love and respect. And here's what it looks like in practical terms, if you would. It comes down to this. Whenever both husband and wife have a decision to make and they're making it for the family together, and you're at an impasse, you have both had the opportunity to share your perspective. The final say, if you're at a disagreement, lays upon the husband. And he will have to give an account for his leadership before the throne of God. The husband that looks at his wife and says, well, honey, I don't care. I'm just going to acquiesce and I'm not going to lead. I'm going to let you lead. He has to give an account for that as well. Verse 24. Now as the church submits to Christ, so wives are to submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, hear me. Love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. Why did Christ give himself for the church? To make her holy, to cleanse her with a washing of the water by the word. He did this to present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or anything like that, but holy and blameless. And then it says in verse 28, in the same way, husbands are to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hates his own flesh, but provides and cares for it, just as Christ does the church, since we are members of his body. Now today, husbands, as you process that passage and as you process your reaffirmation and love for your wife, and as we as Christians process a reaffirming of our love and commitment to the Father, let us remember, husbands, lead. Everything I could say to you to unpack every scripture about marriage and about being a husband and wife, it is boiled down to this one word. And husbands, hear me. And I'm going to ask you to repeat this one word here in just a second. Are you ready? Husbands, lead. Now, if you're a husband, I want you to say that one word. One, two, three.
Lead.
One more time.
Lead.
Oh, okay. Guys, if your team is behind and you're trying to encourage them, I want you to say that one word with a little more gusto, all right? One, two, three.
Lead.
There you go. Lead. Lead. You say, Mike, it's not easy. Neither is submitting to you. However, husbands, the closer you are to Christ, the closer you are to Christ, the easier it is for you to lead. And the closer you are to Christ, husbands, the easier it is for your wife to submit to you. Because she can see and hear your motives and your heart. And when the two of you are pursuing Christ together, more than you're pursuing anything else, the details of leading and submitting fade. Because the focus is honoring Christ. If that makes sense, say it does.
It does.
I love you all. Let's pray. Father, on this Pentecost Sunday, as we remember that you have given your Holy Spirit, you poured it out upon individuals, but God, you poured it out upon the church to strengthen and give courage to the church and enable the church to walk in boldness as we serve one another and reach out and share the gospel and make disciples. Oh, Father, as we reaffirm our commitment and our love to our spouses, Father, may we reaffirm our love and commitment to you and to your church. Because Christ gave his body for the church. And there's no way that any Christian father can say, oh, I love Christ, but I hate his church. Because that would be saying we hate the bride of our Savior. And that must not be. So if we find ourselves there, God may lead us to repentance. Father, some in this place have been called to a life of singleness. May they not look with envy, but may they pursue their calling. Father, some in this place are looking forward to a day that you bring their spouse to them, you bring their mate to them, just as you did in the garden, as Raymond read a moment ago, Father, just as you brought Eve to Adam, and they will rejoice. Oh God, ready and steady our hearts to stay focused upon you, waiting for that day, pursuing you, waiting on the day that you bring that spouse, keeping our relationship pure before you. Now, Father, as we worship you, as we sing with all of our hearts, as we worship you with all of our mind, and as we worship you with all of our body, oh God, be glorified and may you be blessed as your name is exalted. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
We'd invite you to stand again this morning if you'd like. If you can't, please feel free to keep your seats. But if you'd like to, join us. true in your life this morning? Heart continues to sing is because of the way that our God loves us. Oh, what a song to sing. Oh, what a song to sing. Oh, what a song to sing. Forever, forever, our God loves us like that. You know, Jason, as we watch you and Radina exchange vows today, that love is this earthly love, but we can't begin to fathom the love that the Father pours out on us. And it's ours for the taking. It is His reckless love that pursues us to the very ends of the earth. When we get out from underneath God's umbrella of protection, He just scoops us right back in. He's the shepherd that goes out and finds the sheep in the wilderness. He is that God. Love on Him today as He embraces you and loves you.
A word, you were singing over me, amen. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. So kind to me. mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
So we wait for
Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come. Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come. Lord Jesus, come. So we
Am I on now? All right, very good. We are going to, those of you that would like to, you're going to reaffirm your love and commitment to your spouse here in just a moment. But I want to illustrate it like this for just a second. I have in my hand, can anybody tell me what this is? It's a clip, that's right. What happens if you push down on the metal pieces? What happens? It opens. That's right, it opens. If you go if you don't push down, what happens? It closes. So if it's holding something inside, what is held inside is held together as long as it is closed. When the external forces go into work and push it, it opens. Now, listen carefully. Mr. Judah, as well as all of you, listen carefully. These external forces is husband and wife. And when we fight against the will of the Father, everything scatters. Whenever we are in unity and pursuing, when we are pursuing what the Father has for us, when we are pursuing together a relationship with the Father, together and in unity, everything holds together. When you and I, as husband and wife, begin to say, I want my way, I don't care what God's way is, everything goes awry. And whatever I hold inside these clips is now fallen and the wind takes it wherever it will. But when you and I, as husband and wife, will make such a commitment that God is number one, and we will not pursue our own wills by pressing down and releasing everything and creating chaos, but we pursue the Father together. Men, what was that word I used a while ago?
Lead.
Lead. You must lead. In pursuing the Father together first and foremost, so that things stay together in your life. If you are a husband and wife and you have been married, you're legally married, what I'm going to ask you to do, if you want to, if you would like to, is in a moment, in just a moment, you're going to stand, And I'm going to ask you to look at each other. That means eyeball to eyeball. You're not looking at me. You're not looking at anybody else. You're looking at your spouse. And at the same time, as I read this, you're going to say it after, repeat after me to your spouse at the same time. Husband and wife, say it together, repeating after me. Does that make sense? Okay. Would you stand, husbands and wives? Everybody gets nervous when we have to make eye contact. Hi, baby. I love you. All right. Okay. Let me pray for us. Father, as we reaffirm our love and commitment to one another, we do this, yes, to one another, as we remind ourselves of our commitment and our love, but we also confess it to you, Almighty God, and we praise you for the spouse that you have given us. Oh, Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Here we go. You repeat after me. God has given us to each other as husband and wife. We want our love to be a deep and lasting reflection of His love for us. We believe that genuine love is a commitment. Now we want to reaffirm that commitment. We realize that apart from the indwelling, controlling Spirit of God, it is impossible for us to fulfill this commitment. Our confidence is in His ability to produce in our lives that which is pleasing to Him. We are utterly dependent on His grace to live out this commitment for the rest of our lives. As we commit ourselves to Him and to each other, we believe that God, by His grace, will ensure that the feeling of love will also continue throughout our married days. Love you. Now, husbands, I said that to Cindy, not you guys. Now, husbands, here's what I want you to do. If you haven't already done so, and you can do so again, you can kiss your bride. Now, hang on, that was just a kiss. Now, husbands, here's what I want you to do. I want you to, right where you are, I want you to pray a blessing over your wife and your marriage. Do so now. Do so now. I'm going to turn me off. It's me. Give me just a second. Okay. Would you stand with me, please? To leave thee, to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest, I will die, and there I will be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. Words of love and commitment spoken in the Word of God is a picture, if you would, of the commitment that these two express to one another today. Who is here to give this woman in marriage?
I am. Her mother.
Right up. Awesome. Thank you. You may be seated. Let's pray. Oh, Father, thank you. And church, you pray with me, won't you please? Father, thank you for Jason and Redina. God, thank you for their commitment to you first and foremost and to each other. And God, as they take these vows here in this place, we realize your presence is with us. We realize that you are honoring these vows and this commitment, and we praise you for that, Almighty God. These are not entered into lightly, but, O Lord God, with much prayer and much counsel, and we give you the praise and the glory for the fruit that these two will produce all the days of their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Marriage is sacred. It's been ordained by God. As Raymond read earlier, man was incomplete. And because man was incomplete, he created a woman to come alongside him and to encourage him and to complete him. And as Jason has so clearly stated, that's what Redina does for him. The Word of God says that husbands are to love their wives even as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. It is of that type of sacrificial love that we are called to submit to one another and fulfill our commitment before all mankind. There's a certain joy that overflows at a wedding. And so we praise God for that joy. And church family and friends, as you're gathered here and as you're watching via internet, my challenge to you would be to pray for these two, not just today, but in the months and years to come, that they would seek the Father first and foremost, and that they would pursue one another as hard as they pursue their relationship with God. Inasmuch as you've expressed a desire to be united in marriage, I want to ask each of you to take a vow. A vow that is made, yes, before family and friends, but also in the presence of God. Jason, do you take Radina to be your lawfully wedded wife? And do you promise before God and these witnesses to love her, to comfort her, honor and keep her, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only unto her, so long as you both shall live? Jason, do you so promise?
I do.
And Radina, do you take Jason to be your lawfully wedded husband? And do you promise before God and these witnesses to love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only unto him, so long as you both shall live? Radina, do you so promise?
I do.
What do you guys give as an expression and a token of this love and commitment? Right here for just a second. Thank you. The ring is a symbol. The ring is a symbol that tells everyone that sees that ring that we are committed for all of our lives to the other person. But whether that ring is on our finger or not, that commitment maintains. Just like when we're baptized. We don't live in the baptistry, right? That would be wet. But that act of obedience to the Father, being buried in the likeness of his death and being raised to walk in the newness of life in baptism, is similar to the commitment that you're making to one another today. It is an unending commitment and vow that you two have made, and these rings that you exchange today are an expression of that commitment. Jason, if you'll take that ring and place it on her third finger of her left hand, and as you do so, repeat after me. Look at her. With this ring,
I thee wed.
And with all my worldly goods,
I thee endow.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Radina, if you would take that ring. If you'll take that ring and place it upon his third finger of his left hand, and as you do so, repeat after me. With this ring,
I thee wed.
And with all my worldly goods,
I thee endow.
In the name of the Father, and the Son,
and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. We're on. Amen. Amen. You see, these two just made a commitment to one another. As a matter of fact, at the end of their vows that they took just a moment ago, family and friends, tell me, what was those two words they said at the end of their vows? I do. Exactly. Now, let me ask you a question, family and friends. Have you ever said, I do, to Jesus? If you have never submitted yourself to him, you see, these two are submitting themselves to each other. They have submitted themselves to each other publicly and before the Father. have you submitted yourself to Jesus? Until you submit yourself to Jesus and you look at Jesus and you say, Jesus, I do. Well, what does that even mean? Well, listen carefully. You're saying to Jesus, I do deserve eternal separation from you, even because of one of my sins, let alone all of them. I do not deserve your forgiveness. I do not deserve eternal life. But Jesus, I do commit my life to you today, right now. Jesus, I do commit to follow you the rest of my life without shame and without fear. Jesus, today I do turn away from my sins. I repent of my sins. Jesus, I do acknowledge that you are the Savior of my soul. Would you say I do to Jesus today in a commitment to him? That you would live out the rest of your life, just like these two are going to live out this commitment to each other the rest of their life. But your commitment will last the rest of their your life and for all eternity as a follower of Jesus Christ. In just a moment, if you're willing to say, I do, after these two are finalized, you're going to have an opportunity, just as they have done this publicly, you're going to have an opportunity to respond publicly to the drawing of the Holy Spirit. Jason and Redina, by the power invested in me and as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, it's my privilege to pronounce you as husband and wife, and whatsoever God has joined together, let not the hand of man put asunder. Would you pray for your bride?
Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for bringing us here today, Lord, to glorify you, Lord. Lord, thank you for giving me Redina. It's prayers answered, Lord. I don't have the words, Lord, to thank you for what you've done in my life. And Lord, I just ask that you bless every married couple that has come together under you, Lord. And give us the strength, Lord, to not grow complacent, Lord, and not to put the things of this world first, Lord, but give us the courage and the time to go out, Lord, and do your will. And I ask these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Jason, you may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce to you for the first time publicly, Jason and Redina Judah. What do you write?
Thank you, everyone.
Yes. Now, do you say I do? Do you say I do to Jesus? We're going to sing a song of praise. And as we do, I'm going to pray first. I'm going to pray. After I pray, we're going to start singing a song of praise and worship. And then we're going to have our deacons and their wives here. And I'm going to be right here in the middle. And if you are ready, if you today, those of you that are committing the rest of your life to Jesus Christ, repenting of your sins, saying yes, saying I do to Jesus. When we stand, instantly, that's your opportunity to step out and come down. You need to unite with this church, you do the same thing. You need to follow Christ in believer's baptism, you do the same thing. You need to humble yourselves and submit yourself to the Father in prayer. This is an altar for you to come and do so immediately. Father in heaven, as we continue to worship you and as we respond to you, O God, be glorified, be lifted up, O Father. And may our public response in saying I do to you bless your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand with me as we sing. You step out, you come down now in Jesus' name. Come quickly. Come quickly, come now.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saints, let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is
this time of decision is not over. We got people that are praying and being counseled and encouraged, but here, this is for you. Hear me very carefully. If you're ready to say I do to Jesus, you just keep right on coming. There's folks here to receive you. But this is for us, church. Listen to me. One of the greatest fallacies that Satan breathes into our lives as we are courting or dating, whatever you would term would be, is that it is okay to have premarital sex, sex before marriage, because we're already committed to each other and God will understand. Now hear me carefully. The church can be guilty of such unfaithfulness. We get so busy doing whatever that our first and foremost commitment to Jesus Christ becomes second, third, or fourth. And we become unfaithful to our groom. Jesus. I want you to process that with me. Because something that God has... I wish there was a way to put it into words, and so I'm trying. I've been struggling with this for the last several days. Church, if Jesus was to return today, I'm not talking about are you ready? I'm talking about are we ready? You as an individual member, you may go, oh, I'm ready. Send me on that glory train, man. I'm ready to see Jesus face to face. But what about us as a body? You see, the commitment in Ephesians chapter 5 says very, very clearly, we must be ready to submit to the Savior in heaven without stain, without wrinkle, and without blemish as a church. Which means every member, every family is whole and healthy. Raymond? Oh, sorry. Are we there? I know. It puts a check in my spirit too. So church, would you do this with me? Would you pray? Would you pray that we are ready as a church to be presented before the Father without stain, without wrinkle, and without blemish? You see, that starts in the home. That starts in the home. With the home being right before Jesus. And if your home is not right, this church is not right. Yes, it is that serious, and yes, it all goes together. I'm going to pray. And as soon as I'm through, I want you to pray. I want you to pray for this church, please, that we'll be ready when Jesus returns, whether it's today, tomorrow, next year, whenever it is. But Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming soon. We can sing it tritely, but God forgive us for doing so. We must sing it with passion because it's truth. You pray as I pray, then you respond. You respond as the Father leads you, as the Spirit is drawing, you respond. Some to say I do to Jesus, others coming to pray for the healing of your homes, of your marriage, of the church. Father, oh God, we realize the seriousness. And we realize that we could be before your throne even today. And when we sing, oh, Jesus, come, there's such a check in my spirit, but there's such joy at the same time. Oh, Father, are we ready? Is every home ready? What do we need to do to get ready? Oh, God, speak. And may your people respond. In Jesus' name. Amen. Say I do to Jesus, church. Let's go.
There will be justice. All will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true.
Jesus.
praise your holy name. We praise you, O God, because we recognize that you are the same God that parted the Red Seas. You are the same God that allowed your children to walk across where the Red Sea was on dry ground. And yet you caused those waves to crash in on their enemy. You're the same God today. You're the same God that shielded Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from the fiery furnace. You're the same God. You have not changed. And we as a church confess that unashamedly and boldly. You are the same God that caused the axe head to come from the bottom of the water to the top and to float. You're the same God. And we say hallelujah to you, O God. Bless your holy name. You are the same God. You do not change. You are the same God today, yesterday, and forever. You are a good God, a holy God, a righteous God. And we worship you. We worship you. And oh Father, if we are worshiping anything else in our lives, would you show it? Would you reveal it? Surface it? Remove the scales from our eyes. Remove the deafening from our ears. Soften our heart. Let us worship you and you alone, the one true and living God. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. I'm going to ask our deacons to come up here with me for just a moment. Spur of the moment. Sorry, guys. Gary Lanier, would you come up with us, please? I need that stool right there, please. Right here. Church, whatever you need to do, you need to sit, you sit. You need to stand, you stand. We have a member of our body that has multiple things going on inside of him. Matter of fact, is your wife here, brother?
Yes.
Come up here.
Yes, Linda.
Where'd she be?
It's Cindy. Come on.
Let her right here in the midst of you, if you don't mind. Come, both of you. Both of you. Gentlemen, here's some anointing oil. If you want it. All right. Yep, you know what to do. And just pass it around. If you don't know Gary, the doctors believe that his cancer has come back. Multiple spots. They're going to be doing surgery. Is it this coming Friday?
Yes.
This coming Friday. This is scary. Not that he doesn't know where he's going to go. My lands. The man knows where he's going to go. He's been a follower of Christ probably longer than I've been alive. You're welcome. But when one part of the body hurts, we all hurt.
Amen.
And when we rejoice, we all rejoice. Okay? So right where you are, church, if you would, would you pray as these guys pray for Gary and his wife and his family? Would you join them in prayer? You can just lift up your hand, just like right here, right here, touching them with them if you'd like. That's fine. Whatever you need to do. And I want a couple of you guys to pray out loud for healing, if you would. And I'll close this here in just a second, all right? Whoever, I just need two of you, all right? Yes, we do. Yes, Lord. Yes. Yes. Father, I praise you for Gary, I praise you for his family. And oh Father, as a church, we stand in unity, asking for healing unashamedly and boldly. We stand in unity as a church before your throne, lifting up one of your sons, asking that he would be a testimony of your grace, that he would pray for people as he walks through this, that he would encourage others continually as you're healing his body. And all glory and honor goes to you. All praise goes to you, Almighty God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We thank you for praying with us. Our church members are about to take part in giving our tithes and offerings to the Lord. Some of our ushers are going to stay up here and begin to pass the offering plates. As those come before you, we just simply ask, if you're a guest with us, you allow that to pass in front of you. There's no expectation as a guest for you to give anything, all right? This is not on you. This is on our members. We have the privilege and joy of giving a tithe and to give an offering before our God. Just to remind you, we're making up the $7,000 still for the roof. By the way, the roof repair begins tomorrow.
Yes.
And that, yeah, praise yes. God. That's right. That's right. Praise the Lord. Roof repair begins tomorrow, and we praise God for that. We pulled $7,000 from our checking to help complete that. So if you would, as the Lord leads, put that in an offering envelope that's in your chair, or mark it somehow in your check. This goes to the above and beyond their tithe. It's the 7,000 part, all right? Make sure you put that on the envelope or somewhere on your check or whatever. Father in heaven, bless, O Lord God, the tithes that we give. As we give with a joyful heart, as we give with a smile on our face, because you allow us the opportunity. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name.
My
worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever. I'm gonna worship you. I'm gonna worship you forever.
Charlotte Red, if you and your husband could come on up here. This is James. James, you might remember from the... Come on, I don't... James, you might remember from the baptistry a couple of weeks ago.
Yes.
He became a follower of Christ. This is his wife, Charlotte. She is a follower of Christ, and she comes desiring to unite with our church as a member. First Baptist Church, Aztec. Isn't that exciting?
Awesome.
Amen. Woo-hoo. You guys don't go anywhere. Wait up. And Deborah, would you come join me?
Where'd she go?
Then I have to come back there.
It's Debbie. Oh.
The choice is yours. All right, stand up.
I was just wondering why I
do. All right, so this is Deborah. Don't you love her?
Yes, I love you, Debbie.
They all know me.
Yeah.
This not everybody knows you.
Yeah, they do.
Okay. Today, she comes saying I do to Jesus.
Amen.
And reaffirming that relationship, reaffirming that commitment to Jesus. And so I'm looking forward to continuing to visit with her about that reaffirmation in her life. And if you will commit to pray for her, would you say a hearty praise the Lord?
Praise.
There you go, sister. All right, you're welcome. All right. There you go. Don't say no to the pastor. Come on. Love you, Deborah.
She's mobile.
All right. Well, am I forgetting anything? Is that it? Okay. Reception afterwards. We have a reception in the fellowship hall. There are some beautiful cakes in there. Some beautiful wedding cakes in there, as well as some finger foods and some other things. I don't know if there's anything healthy at all. Yes. So there is some veggies. Bummer. Then the guilt trip has me. All right. So in just a moment, Jerry Jude is going to come up and dismiss us in prayer. He'll need a microphone to do that. I ask you, if you would, to join us in the fellowship hall for a reception. And as soon as Jerry says amen, I want you two to slide out and go to the fellowship hall, okay? All right? And then if you're a guest here with us today, as pastor, I would love to get to meet you right outside those doors. If you go straight down that hallway right there, I'm going to be there, and we've got a soda and a candy bar with your name on it. I think it's going to be your favorite. So if you would come down and meet me, I would love to get to meet you, all right? So I look forward to meeting you down there as our guest here in just a moment. All right, Jerry, won't you come? Thank you.
Father God, we thank you so much. We are so blessed as a church and as a community who has such a faithful and loving God. I thank you, Lord God, for what you've been doing in our lives. I thank you for my sons, my wives, my children, Heavenly Father, and our friends here at church. I thank you for all the blessings, Lord God, that you keep showing us that you are still alive and strong in all the hearts of your children. Heavenly Father, we praise you and glorify in all of your goodness. I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.